This episode of the Nerf Herder Council is brought to you by Audible. Visit audibletrial.com/NHC for your 30-day trial and a free audiobook download. Warning, the following podcast contains irreverent humor, exceptionally nerdy opinions, potential cursing, and plenty of love for the prequels. If any of the preceding offends you, please turn off this podcast immediately, and may the Force be with you.
Why, you stuck-up, half-witted, scruffy-looking Nerf herder!
You can't use that word! Only we can use that word!
I can take him.
Let me at him.
Absolutely not.
Han, these guys are serious gamblers.
I'm serious. Stick me.
Don't listen to him.
You're tuned in to the Nerf Herder Council, your source for Star Wars opinion, conversation, and debate. Featuring your hosts, JT.
You really could technically thaw out Princess Leia like a damn toaster strudel, and she'd be alive. I think I have a new intro clip.
AJ.
Chewie, crack a window. The cold air keeps me awake.
Steve.
It's a sign of any good audio podcast is visuals,
right?
On this episode of the Nerf Herder Council, using Rogue One and Solo A Star Wars Story as our backdrop, we discuss just what makes a good standalone Star Wars film.
This is the Nerf Herder Council.
What is up, everybody? Welcome to another episode of the Nerf Herder Council. I am your host, JT. With me is AJ. Steve is on vacation. He always claims that he just can't make ends meet in order to get to Celebration, but here he is at Disney for a second time this year. So I think he's full of crap. What do you think?
I think he's our roving reporter. He's going down there to get a firsthand account of what's going on at Galaxy's Edge.
He better send us some pictures. That's all I know.
Well, we're going to go with that anyway, because personally, yeah, I agree with you. I think it's kind of crap.
Lazy bastard. But
3 years into the show and he can't go to Celebration, but he's been to Disney how many times now? Three.
Yeah. So I believe he can go to Celebration. So, we are actually recording on location today. On location, touring around the nation. NHC boys, one's on vacation. How's that for a Beastie Boys reference for you? But we are actually in my man cave, which it usually does not get visited by many people besides myself. And
is that why it smells so bad in here?
No, it smells great. It smells like a pumpkin spice candle. I'm that doucher. So, but it's got all my wonderful knickknacks, my life-size Han Solo. Look at how much Star Wars stuff there really is around my man cave. There's tons of stuff.
That is true. This is a great room for that.
It really looks like a 19-year-old's dorm room at college.
It really does. I'm sitting on a futon that's got, let's see, we got a Star Wars blanket. We got an R2-D2 pillow, a Star Wars Last Jedi pillow, Darth Vader pillow. Wow, you like your pillows, man.
I do. Because that's the side I lean on.
Ah.
So it's like it's all comfortable. And don't forget that the futon has a name. That's Vladimir Putin. So you're sitting on Vlad.
Here, let's get this on mic. That's me banging my head against the microphone, guys.
You're the one that's going to have to edit that out. We've got my Darth Vader edition PS4. I've got all the Blu-rays and everything. I mean, you name it, there's Star Wars everywhere in here, but I'm a nerd and it looks like a nerd's, looks like a nerd's man cave.
You got the Millennium Falcon under construction. Don't forget that.
That is not under construction. It is currently in the shipyard. That's
all right.
See, I got it figured out, man. The Black Series corner is up here where I hide all my Black Series from my wife. So she doesn't know how many I really have. So that's always a good place to see. But we are actually up in my man cave. So it's the first time we've recorded here. So let's hope it sounds worth a damn. And before we get started, we definitely want to thank Galactic Empire for our theme music. Don't forget, we are brought to you by Audible. Go to audibletrial.com/NHC for your 30-day trial and a free audiobook download. And go to I know you're changing it up, but if you would like to get a custom Nerf Herder Council t-shirt, which we actually got one in the mail and it looks awesome.
Yes, I can vouch for that.
Yes, they look great. Go to teepublic.com. That's teepublic.com/user/NHC. And AJ, being the web guy that he is for us, is currently in the process of making that easier to find. So
yeah, if I get off my lazy ass, then hopefully by the time this comes out, you can just go to shop.nhcpodcast.com and get there directly. So
boy, would that be better?
Yeah.
Wow. Oh, speaking of lazy ass, you forgot to send me the logo for my new Cleveland Browns podcast, which is called the Dog Pound Podcast. You can check it out on Spreaker.
Ah, okay. Did you get around to re-recording that intro yet?
It's fairly similar, but I did shorten it up quite a bit. So
like someone might have been, okay.
Yeah. You know,
that's a sidebar.
Exactly. So, anyways, so thanks for tuning in to another episode of the show. Hope you guys are digging the short format. I actually kind of am. AJ and I were talking off air and I'm actually enjoying it. I didn't think I would, but I actually am kind of enjoying it. So hope you guys are too. Thanks for checking it out.
I enjoy talking to you less.
I think you're very rude. So tonight, because we're kind of doing what we do, this is actually, in a way, this is like the genesis of the
genesis?
I knew we were both gonna say it.
We could feel it in the air tonight.
Oh my gosh. So we go from Star Trek to the actual band. All right, yeah, Phil Collins. Anyway, so this is kind of like the genesis of the podcast, in that we had the idea to actually start recording these conversations that we would do like we are now, having some drinks and just, you know, BSing about Star Wars and saying, what if we put a microphone in front of our faces and just, you know, see what happens. Maybe people would listen, and, you know, about 3 or 4 people have. So, it's, you know, it's a good thing. So we're kind of back to our roots on this one. So
maybe that's why the numbers are pretty steady.
Yeah.
People tune in. They listen, they go, oh, I'm not listening to this again.
Exactly.
And then new people stumble across it, not knowing any better. And they tune in and they go, oh, I'm not listening to this anymore.
We have the highest percentage of new listeners of any podcast
right,
that's ever been created.
Right, I wonder what the turnover is.
It's like a 98% turnover ratio. We just keep finding a new audience. If we could keep an audience, we'd have like millions of downloads.
We have a turnover ratio like the Cleveland Browns defense.
Hey, man, they only forced 13 turnovers all of last season, and they forced 6 in the first game. So things are looking up for us finally.
I know. That was a Steelers slam right there. Aren't
I
you proud
know.
Of me?
I am proud
yeah.
of you. So what we wanted to talk about tonight is we wanted to get into a comparison kind of analysis of Rogue One versus Solo, because there are a lot of similarities in the two films that I think can kind of give us a roadmap for success that Disney could use to actually continue putting out these standalone films on a regular basis. Because I think the quality of these two films tells us that doing so would be a very good idea. I think, and I'll start here because I was actually thinking about this today, because we've talked about Rogue One lately, and Rogue One, I think, is a story that people really wanted to see. You know, if you go, I mean, we said there's similarities between the movies. So of course my dumbass is going to bring up a difference right off the bat. So that's good. But, you know, Rogue One is a story that I think people wanted to see. When you announce, hey, it's about how they get the Death Star plans, people are like, ooh, how'd they do that? And when people say, oh, it's Han Solo's backstory, a lot of the backlash was, well, why do we need to see that? So,
okay.
I think if they find other stories that people really want to hear about, they can definitely, definitely make a successful film out of it. So I'll start with you. What do you,
better. I'm the only one here.
Yeah. I'll start with Steve. Oh yeah. I forgot.
Apparently we're starting with Bubba.
Yeah. So that is,
he's getting involved.
Yes. That is my cat Bubba that we are hearing in the background. He is like, he is the hippest cat there ever was. So, is that Bubba on mic? Yes, it is. So I'll start with you. What do you think is a common, like the strongest common thread between the two films that would really kind of, you know, give Disney a good starting point?
Well, that's a tough question, because my basis for even coming up with this idea was there's so many similarities between the films, and yet the reception for the two was so different. So I can point out some similarities, but they don't have any bearing, it seems, on the success of the films. So, I mean, which way would you go? Like you said, Rogue One, I think people were excited because it was a story that no one realized they missed that story.
Yeah.
Because it was just a throwaway line in the crawl of episode 4. And yet once people had that like dangled in front of them, like, oh, wow, the Death Star plans. Yeah, that'd be like super cool. So I guess, like you said, you got to go back into other like throwaway events or mentions that happen in other films and see where there are untold stories there.
Yeah. I mean, we've said many times, and I don't know how well this would be received, but I think by prequel fans, you know, like you and I have said, we'd like to see this. I mean, the whole Sifo Dyas thing, mm-hmm. you know, the actual ordering of the clone army and where, you know, the Jedi Council kind of, you know, had a rogue member that was, you know, operating on the, you know, in cahoots with the dark side or what, however it played out.
I think Plagueis, not to the letter of the book, because things have changed and they wouldn't want to just put the book on film, but that would be an intriguing story. The whole thing of like, how did Palpatine rise to power in the dark side, not politically,
right,
and set the stage for episode 1. I think that'd be a really cool story to tell.
See, and that's where I was going to start, is the fact that I think that one of the things that, you know, ties these two movies together, and I think the reason that, I mean, while there wasn't a big interest in the Solo movie for a couple different reasons, they're both very, very high quality films. I really, really like them both. If you notice, they both kind of delve deeper into original trilogy lore. And while you can't continue to do that all the time, I think if they did that and brought more elements from the prequels into it, so you kind of have a gradual shift into prequel era stuff, I think that would be a starting place.
Yeah, I think Solo can also be a cautionary tale too. The one thing I was noticing is a big difference between them, because they do take place in a similar era, and mm-hmm. there have been a lot of stories told between episode 3 and 4, which is, I think the reason we didn't get that with George Lucas is because in his mind, there was really nothing going on there. Like once the Empire gets created in episode 3, it's just them spreading their influence and twisting the galaxy to their will for the next 20 years. So Disney came along and started telling stories in between that time period, saying that there are things going on, but like Solo focuses solely on the underworld. And that's where a lot of the stories were going to come from. In fact, George even had that live action series in mind called Star Wars Underworld.
Yep.
And I think maybe one of the things where Solo falls flat is that while the Empire is in the movie, they don't really have much of a role. They're around, but it's really about the criminal underworld. So there's the main conflict of Star Wars, of rebels versus Empire, or, you know, Republic versus Separatists, whatever it is. The main conflict of the entire Skywalker saga is not really a part of the Solo story. I think that's why it's kind of dismissible.
Yeah, I'm really interested to see the deleted scenes in that, to see what they left out. This sounds so dumb, but I mean, there's been reviews of the deleted scenes, like saying what they are and whatnot. And, you know, it comes out digitally on Friday.
I purposely haven't read any spoilers on that stuff.
Yeah, I haven't either, because I want to see what they are. I did catch one by accident. So I won't spoil it for you, but it is something you were just mentioning. It does delve into.
Does it explain that damn TIE fighter with the extra gun pod on it? Because even the Solo book that I got, the Visual Dictionary, doesn't have that.
What book was... You had another one of the art books that actually... We were looking for something in there that they didn't have. Was it the Rogue One book or was it The Last Jedi? Because we were looking for something.
Well, let's see. The first one I got was the Rogue One book.
Did it not have Boar Gullet or something?
Yeah, I think that was it. I think it was...
Yeah, because we were like, where the hell...
Boar Gullet! Boar Gullet!
But, yeah, I... It's
totally not the way the line goes, by the way.
Yeah, I know. It's close enough. Well, actually, that's the only line he says. He just says Boar Gullet. And he's like, what? Boar Gullet? And then, yeah. You know, then afterwards is when it shows the thing going up to him. But
tends to lose one's mind.
We are a quote machine on this show.
The superfluous lip smack. I love that. That was a great little character beat there. I actually love that.
Yes, I agree. Made me forget my point there. But
yeah, it's too easy to fall into a love letter to Rogue One because we both love that movie so much.
It's a fantastic movie. Oh, I know what I was going to say. Yeah, I'm purposely not looking at any descriptions of the deleted scenes on Solo, because it comes out Friday. I'm off work, so the first thing I'm going to do when I wake up is, you know, fire up the digital and watch it. I've got the 3D Blu-ray on pre-order, and so I'll watch that when it gets here in a couple weeks. But from what I can gather, there's more story exposition about things that people wanted to see in Solo in the deleted scenes. So I'm interested to see what those actually show. Mm. Since you don't want spoilers, I won't give away the one thing that I
might be spoiling it for myself. I just started today listening to today out. Hold on a second. I got cat claws in my kneecap. Thank you, Bubba.
See, we do have a third host.
Oh man.
Yeah.
You know, when Ace is down at my feet, when we're recording in Steve's basement, he's perfectly well behaved. Well, your cat could take a lesson from my dog.
No, Bubba would die without human interaction. I'm fully convinced of that. He's hip as hell, but yeah. He would die. So
anyway, I started listening to the expanded novelization today.
Okay.
Which I'm guessing has a lot of those deleted scenes just written in.
People have said that might be like, if not one of the, then definitely the best novelization of any of the films so far.
Wow. Okay. Well, I'm intrigued then. Yeah. I'm only on chapter 4 of 23, so I got a long way to go.
Well, isn't there, there's a lot of stuff with him in the Imperial Navy at the beginning, isn't there?
I haven't gotten there yet.
Okay.
They're just now getting to the Imperial Processing Center.
Okay.
They just escaped Moloch and they're going to make their escape off Corellia, or attempt to.
Okay.
I don't think Kira's going to make it.
I wonder how it turns out. Yeah, no, you know, back to a point I was making before to get us a little bit, you know, back on track what we were saying here, but you know, starting out with like original trilogy stuff. And then I think one of the things that was cool about Solo was that it did bring the prequel stuff into it. And I think if you kind of then, you know, let's say that Solo was 80%, 80% original trilogy and 20% prequel trilogy. You know, they could then go like a 70-30 and then a 60-40 and kind of start skewing it. I just wonder how prequel era stories would be received, because, you know, I think the one thing that Solo did is it did do damage to the whole, let's tell the backstory, you know, aspect of things. Because as much as people say, oh, I would totally watch a Ewan McGregor, Obi-Wan Kenobi movie. Well, what story are you going to tell? I mean, there's literally nothing that was ever mentioned. At least with Han Solo, you had stuff in the books where it's like, okay, he was in the Imperial Navy. You know, he met Chewbacca. He got, you know, he got the Millennium Falcon. He did the Kessel Run. With Obi-Wan Kenobi, it's like, nah, he became an old fart in the desert. So what's right? There to tell? I mean, that would be so interesting to me, because I mean, the fan reaction so far to a Ewan McGregor Obi-Wan Kenobi movie has been really positive, and yet there's not a story to tell. So, and you would think that Han Solo is a more popular character than Obi-Wan. So why wouldn't a Solo movie be more successful than the Obi-Wan movie? But I swear the Obi-Wan movie would do better than Han Solo.
You know, it might be true, because Ewan McGregor was one of the few bright spots that everyone can universally agree upon was great in the prequels. Like, he nailed the character and
probably the best part about it.
Yeah. Yeah. And them, very consistent. I would say it's the most consistent part for sure.
Yeah.
Like, there's no one going like, I don't believe him as becoming the Alec Guinness character in the original trilogy. Like, no, that's a seamless transition right there. That's really well done.
Yeah, it is.
But like you said, there's not a whole lot to tell there. So I think it would get by on the popularity of the concept. But again, as we discussed on previous shows, a strong box office, or at least a strong debut, does not mean it's a good story. That just means there's good hype built up for it. People got to go in and spend their money first and then decide if they are happy with what they spent their money on.
Yeah. How do you, it's weird. Like, how do you generate, this is not a word, but rewatchability? Because I mean, people went to see The Force Awakens. Obviously that was a nostalgia trip for a lot of people, that, you know, so it made $2 billion. Rogue One had that singular story like Solo, and yet people went to watch it more often, and Solo, they really didn't.
Yeah. And that was the weird thing, because there was so much more world building going on in Solo.
Yeah.
They really, it's very obvious that they made this movie so they could tell any number of stories based off of things that they dropped in this. I mean, you've got Corellia in the way it looks now, the spice mines of Kessel raise all kinds of interesting things that they could do. Obviously there's Crimson Dawn. So any number of directions they could go. And yet I think maybe the story kind of suffered because with Rogue One, like it was a completely untold story with characters you didn't know about. So I think maybe there was more to go back and chew on later. Whereas like with Solo, you just passively accept everything you see on the screen. And yeah, we can get more stories about that, but no, that doesn't really hold up. See, this is why I wanted to bring this to the table, is because every time I try to think of a reason that would explain the difference in reception, I can counter it right away. Because we're still talking about unknown characters, and yet people were invested enough in some aspect of Rogue One that they went back and watched it a bunch. But another bunch of unknown characters, like we said, we never really cared about Rio Durant or Val, you know, or Dryden Voss even. All these people that we get introduced to in Solo, and there's so much more to tell. And yet I could take it or leave it if we find out more about it.
I disagree.
Kira and Maul are the only two things that I really want to know more about.
I think, you know, and not to, I swear I'm not like self-glossing us. So if I come across this way to anybody listening, I apologize. I don't mean it to sound this way, but in the course of our discussions, we always like stumble upon things we never really thought about. So it's like, you know, it's a very natural conversation on our show. And I thought when we got on the topic of what a Solo sequel could be, when we were revisiting it a few episodes ago, I got really excited because I realized that there is a ton of potential for a really cool sequel, because you do have to bring in Boba Fett or Jabba the Hutt or both. And you know, you have Maul and these other characters, and
exactly. Solo, but you're talking about established characters. You're not talking about characters you met in Solo,
but you can. Yeah. I mean, but then again, that does play into my point of, you know, original trilogy characters and let's just, you know, make it even a more broad generalization, characters that we already know. I mean, so you do bring them back in there. So there was one of the things I said could be a recipe for success. That is one thing the movies have in common. You automatically bring those characters in there just based on what you did in Solo.
Well, they could take a page out of the Marvel formula a little bit. You notice how every Captain America movie, they expand the cast a little bit and bring in other characters.
Mm-hmm.
So where Captain America movies became just Avengers sub-movies.
Yeah.
Civil War was just cram-packed with them. So,
well, they called that Avengers, what, two and a half.
Yeah.
It really was.
Even Captain America 2. I mean, you still had Black Widow and, God, I'm blanking out, Winter Soldier.
Nick Fury,
yeah. I mean,
Agent Hill.
It was one of the first Solo movies that had significant roles played by other characters.
Yeah.
And Solo could be the same way. You start broadening that cast and put Han Solo in the path of other characters that we know he's got a history with. And yeah, you could build off of it, but you're building off of it because you already know those characters. No one's like, well, let's see who's still alive at the end of Solo that you just met. They went the Rogue One route with that. They just killed everybody off.
Wait a minute.
Kira's the only new character that's really still alive.
Wait a minute. Enfys Nest,
yeah.
I mean, what the Cloud Riders, they're called? Yeah, Cloud Riders. I mean, you do have that, which is, you know, that was a very well-received character.
They're just another rebel cell, just like Saw's group, though. They're just somebody else who in 4 or 5 years might start being a thing that matters.
Yeah, but see, that would make it really cool, because then you're starting to see, like, on one hand, you can see, like, the birth of the rebellion, and then on the other hand, you can bring in these characters that people have wanted to see, because, like, you know, people have said, oh, there's going to be a Boba Fett movie. But I mean, you're the most vocal proponent of not doing that, because, like, what are you going to do? But if Boba Fett is then a secondary character, albeit a major secondary character in a Solo sequel, that would still be cool, because you're not giving away a ton about him. So he's still got that cool mystique, but he's there, and you get to see Jabba the Hutt again. So you're actually taking the story into these places that people would want to see. And I just made the most amazing segue without even realizing it, because my next point that I wanted to bring up, if we ever got there, which I just got there naturally, is one of the things that I think both movies does really, really well is they take things that we know how they happen, or that they happen, I should say. Mm-hmm. And they don't explain them in a way where you roll your eyes or you're like, oh, that's cheesy. It's like, you know, when Han got the Millennium Falcon, that was really cool, you know, because it wasn't okay. First game of Sabacc, he wins it. Now he's got the Millennium Falcon. No, it wasn't like that. You know, he had to go through the whole movie to get it. You know, the DL-44, that one they just kind of glossed over. They didn't make a giant deal about, oh, now he's got this, you know, super famous gun. You know, the Kessel Run, like we were saying before, it's like, you know, you thought it was just he went really fast. But no, it's actually this pain in the ass thing that he had to do. So they explained it really cool. And in the story of Rogue One, they didn't just take, it's a bunch of guys, we're good guys and we're going to go steal the Death Star plans. Like, you know, it was, they explained it in such a cool way. So I think if you did a sequel to Solo and you have the Enfys Nest and, you know, the birth of the rebellion, and you can tie that into, you know, Crimson Dawn with, you know, and you can introduce Jabba the Hutt and Boba Fett and characters like that into the story. The if they can write that the way that they did, you know, those fan nuggets in Solo and the overarching story of Rogue One, that would make a kick ass movie.
Oh, we agreed that the pieces are there for a sequel for sure. They left plenty of plot threads dangling, especially in that time period, because like you said, you've got Jabba's. Is there just the Hutts period? Is there a name for his group? The Hutt Cartel?
I think it's the Hutt Cartel. Don't quote me on that. Even though I am a 6-time Star Wars trivia champion, but we'll get to that at the end of the show.
So you got the Hutts going on their thing, and Han's allied with them, and obviously Kira's with Crimson Dawn. And we know that Crimson Dawn is not a thing by the time we see Maul and Rebels. So there's obviously some fallout there that we could check out.
Yep.
And that would put Kira back in the path of Han. And you know, yeah, there's all kinds of story directions there. So I'm not saying that there's nothing to pull on from Solo, but what we started talking about was, why wasn't there enough in Solo for people to go back and watch it again?
That one, I think we already explained, and I think we nailed it, is that it's the same.
Well, then take the inverse. What is in Rogue One that people went back and saw it a bunch of times? Because they did. They totally did.
I'm going to really oversimplify this, but I think Rogue One was such a good movie that people wanted to see it again. It's the thing that I always dispute Steve about, is that when he says, I just couldn't get invested in the characters. I was totally invested in it. I mean, it had such a heart to it, and you actually got into the stories. I mean, you had the friendship with Chirrut and Baze, and you had, you know, Jin on, you know, it was kind of a standard, you know, bad guy turns to good guy type of a thing. But, you know, Cassian Andor was, you know, he was a rebel, but he was tasked with killing, you know, this person's father. And, you know, there's that internal struggle. And then you had K2SO, who was the first time we'd seen a droid that wasn't just like so robotic, you know, the first humanistic droid, and was really funny. Like, there was so much there. And Solo, for as awesome as it was, it's pretty much a straight up action flick.
And it's also a straight up standalone movie.
Yeah, exactly.
Like Rogue One slots directly into the events of the main saga.
Yeah, that's an excellent point, because Solo really is it is the only movie that nothing in that movie in a major way directly affects anything else that's happened in the other, you know, 9 films that they've released.
Mm-hmm.
That's a really good point. Like I said, it's a fantastic movie.
Do you think this might grow in popularity in the future then? Well, I mean, for myself, I'm super stoked, probably because I've only seen it twice, but I'm super stoked for the release, which will actually have happened 2 days before this episode comes out. Mm-hmm. But, I haven't seen it that much, and it's new Star Wars, so of course I'm stoked. I'm super pumped about it. And we think about stuff like, I was going to go with the point that things that don't tie into the main saga, people crap all over, because people crap all over like Finn and Rose going to Cantonica in episode 8. But I think it feels like one of the major points that's going to play out in the overall saga is that them being there and spreading the message of the Resistance. And then the last scene in the entire movie is the kid with the ring and holding the broom like a lightsaber, and turns out he's force sensitive.
Right.
Like, that could have major ramifications down the line. Like, maybe Solo is the same way, where they set up a bunch of stuff that in future stories will bear fruit. So right now it seems like a throwaway story, but then maybe down the line, after there are more movies coming out, more plot points, it could go down as one of those movies where like, oh, this is where all that stuff started.
Yeah. I would love it if they did. And I thought about this the other day. Let's say they did a sequel to Solo, And because there's so much, it's Solo is such a weird anomaly to me, because like pretty much people love the movie, but so many people didn't see it because they're like, oh, I don't give a crap about the backstory of Han Solo. All those people are stupid. I just want to tell you that right now. If you're one of those people that doesn't want to know more about Han Solo, you are very, very wrong. But if they made the exact same movie and instead of calling it Solo 2, you know, they called it, you know, like Desert Rats or something, and word came out that it's Han Solo and Boba Fett and Jabba the Hutt. Do you think that that movie would like explode? Cause I kind of think it might.
It could. It really could. It's too bad they already used the title Scoundrels for a book.
Yeah.
Because if that was the title of the sequel, that would just be broad enough, but clever enough that it would kind of intrigue people.
Was that one right before the Disney acquisition, or is that one canon? Because I always forget. That's kind of in that gray area for me.
It's new canon as far as I know.
It is? Okay.
Well, no. I always have to frame it in terms of celebrations.
And I thought the same thing because we had that excerpt that we got. Yeah.
Disney bought Star Wars in 2012. That was Scoundrels our second celebration.
Scoundrels came out before Bloodline, though, didn't it? Like the Chuck Wendig trilogy is really the first novels that mark new written canon.
The first new book to come out under Disney's new canon was A New Dawn. It was the Rebels prequel.
Yeah, okay. Never finished that one.
I mean, there's not much to it. You know the guy dies, so.
Yeah, yeah, right?
He gets blinded, he dies. It's a thing Jedi do. But, yeah, so I think Scoundrels came out after that. It had to have. Or it was like right around the same time, because I swear that we were at the Orange County Convention Center when we got that. And it wasn't last year. So it must have been in 2012.
Well, three of the last four were in Orlando. It's kind of hard to.
I remember our first one, and it wasn't part of that.
Didn't you know what? Okay.
So it must
I think
have been
I can remember, because we got that excerpt from, it was from the bounty hunt, because we had to look through a bunch of the books for answers to the bounty hunt questions.
That was the second one. Then that was 2012, the year Disney bought Star Wars.
That would have been. Man, because that was August of 2012. So it wouldn't have been canon, though, because the sale, even if it had been announced, it wasn't immediately canon.
I think Celebration happened like right when the sale took place, right?
It was right around there.
Like Celebration had already been announced and then Disney bought them or something like that.
I don't think the Disney thing had been announced at Celebration, because I think everyone would have been losing their minds at Celebration about that, going, oh, there's new Star Wars. But that wasn't the case. Because remember all the rage at that one was the 35th anniversary of episode four.
That's right. Okay.
So, all right. Well, I don't think it's canon then. If we are wrong, please correct us. Cause we're not going to jump on our cell phones while we're in the middle of recording a podcast, but so,
plus now you have to talk to us. Yeah. Feedback at nerfherdercouncil.com.
Exactly. I don't know. I really think that there's so much there to be mined in a Solo sequel, but you know, to get back to the original point, I think those original trilogy characters really help. And again, excuse me, the way that they've written those standalone films, if they can get, I really think that's my biggest thing. If they can get a combination of the quality of writing that they've gotten with Rogue One and Solo in terms of telling us stories where we know how it ends, but the way we get there is really original and just not, you know, clod hopping from one point to the other and making it obvious. If they can combine that with a story that someone actually might give a damn about, I think that would be good. And so it's like, I'm gonna bring this back. So Kenobi, there's no one really knows what the hell you're gonna tell about Ben Kenobi, except for he's aging in the desert. You know, he's getting melanoma because he's in the sun all the time. you know, he's cleaning up Bantha crap from his front porch or something.
Well, if they did anything like the book, he's whining to Qui-Gon through the Force.
Okay. Yeah. I didn't even bother with that. I just had no desire.
It's a whole bunch of him trying to do Jedi stuff without revealing he's a Jedi. It's just, yeah, whatever. It's a disposable book.
Yeah. That, and
it doesn't count anymore. So it's okay.
Yeah. Right. yeah. I mean, I really wonder if the future success of these movies is in not naming them the character. Like, if, I mean, if they would have named Solo something different, it sounds so dumb, but for casual fans, maybe if it was called, you know, just Birth of a Hero or something like that, instead of Solo, they'd be like, oh, it's a new Star Wars movie. And if they didn't really pay close enough attention to know that, okay, it's all about Han Solo, I wonder if more people would have gone. I always wonder that. Because of that main complaint that, well, we don't need the backstory of Han Solo. Well, if somebody doesn't know it's the backstory of Han Solo, how many of the casual fans that said they don't want to see that would have gone if they didn't know it because of the title? It sounds dumb, but some people don't research this crap.
You know, you could be onto something there. I mean, Rogue One is kind of the name of the group, but that comes in later, and it's not a name you already know. So even though it is the name of the people involved and not the thing that they're doing, it's not as on the nose as Solo. So it's not as obvious that the movie exists strictly for the reason of telling more things about this character.
Yeah.
You know, so it takes the focus off of who's in it and puts the focus more on what's going on.
Yeah. I think my questioning of this comes from personal experience, because I had some friends of mine who are, you know, they're casual fans. And I had a few of them ask me, what Rogue One, what the heck is that about? And literally it was split down the middle. Half of them, I told them all, I said, oh, this is the story about how the rebels get the Death Star plans. And half of them went, oh, that sounds pretty cool, I would go see that. And the other half went, well, I'm not going to go. Why do I care about that story? But, you know, because so you see what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, people didn't know. There are people that did not know what it was about. And, you know, these people that said, oh, I don't care about that story, I'm not going to go, they were actually interested in it because it was a Star Wars movie. So if they hadn't had it told to them what it was about, there's some more ticket sales they could have gotten. Yeah. So not naming it, so like, oh, here, we're going to do a Boba Fett movie. What's it called? Boba Fett. Like, it's called Fett.
You know, actually, I think I might have just stumbled onto something here as you were talking. Like, we were talking about the ideas for a Solo sequel and how it basically pulls everything closer to the events we already know, because it ties in people we already know. And that's where Rogue One is different than Solo. And I think that's one of the reasons it succeeds. Rogue One is, it's like looking at, What was one of the main gripes of Episode One is that it's nothing like the Star Wars that we know.
Yeah.
Because it deliberately wasn't. It was the start of something that had to progress through two more movies and 50 years of galactic history to get to Star Wars that we knew. It was too far away from the thing that was familiar and that we identified with. And Solo is kind of like the same way. Solo is like the Episode One of spinoffs, whereas Rogue One is, we jokingly called it Episode 3.5.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So it was right on all the stuff that we recognize. So it was super cool to see it tie in. Solo is so far removed from things that we recognize that once it starts getting closer to it, and those are all the parts that we like best about Solo anyway, is the stuff that we can recognize from other movies. You know, oh, this is the Kessel Run we heard about. That's the cool part. You know, it's not, as much as we love the Convey-X scene and stealing the coaxium, we don't really care. It was a fun action bit, but it's disposable because it has no bearing or attachment to anything we recognize. Enfys Nest didn't actually matter until we come to find out, oh, she's forming the rebellion.
Yeah.
Then it got cool. So, yeah, I think Solo's flaw was in going too far back and pulling too far away from the main storyline that we can identify with.
I just will always be surprised that there's not more people that wanted his backstory. And I mean, because he's such a popular character, and I know I'm biased because he's my favorite, but I mean, I'm not telling tales out of school to say that people really, really love that character. I mean, he is one of the most popular characters in cinematic history. That's just a fact. Mm-hmm. So the fact that more people didn't go to that movie always shocks me. And I think I'm probably just living in denial over the fact that stupid Last Jedi backlash had something to do with it. Cause that just will forever piss me off. And I'm really glad I've never met anybody in person that's actually told me like, well, I hated The Last Jedi so much that I didn't go to see Solo. Cause I'd probably smack him.
Now, I think the two points, I don't think it's so much the backlash as people have said. I think it's just poor marketing.
Now that's true.
They didn't give it enough lead time and, they put it out too soon.
Well, I think
it had like 8 weeks to drum up serious buzz. And we had just gotten a Star Wars movie 5 months prior. And 2 months prior, we were just still gushing over the Blu-ray release of The Last Jedi. It was just not enough time to drum up enough interest in it.
When you phrase it that way, I think you can really say that pretty much in all aspects, Rogue One did it right where Solo did not. It was a more saga oriented film with way more time to promote, way more marketing. And just everything about it was done properly. People, I think, were more interested in getting that story.
And it was only the second movie Disney had done. So there might be a fatigue factor just by the regular release schedule.
Yeah. I mean, the once a year thing has got to continue because even for me, and we said this on you know, previous episodes, but I mean, getting hyped up for Solo, as much as we love Star Wars, like now that, like you said, we're waiting for the digital releases and then there's, you know, there's the cartoons and stuff like that. It's not like it was before where, you know, there's 3 years between movies and you're just like completely crapping your pants for, you know, the release of the next episode. It's, you know, a year is good because that's a long time.
It's long enough, especially with our shorter attention spans now, that's long enough to build up the hype, but not so long that you're just pissed off and you move on to other things.
Yep. Have you ever gone back and thought about how in the hell we dealt with a 3 year wait between movies back then?
Oh God. Yeah.
As big of fans as we are, I think back to that going, how did I wait that long?
You know, I don't even know. I think it's because we didn't have the internet and social media to like drum it into our heads on a daily basis. So we weren't stuck on Star Wars as much as we are now.
Yeah.
But yeah, like we're looking at episode 9 and it's 15 months away and we're already in this like doldrum of like, oh God, like you remember the end of Ren and Stimpy where it was like, goodbye for now. Uh-huh. And I was like, well, what do we do? Till next time. It's like, oh, what do we do till then? Like Stimpy's all freaking out. Like, oh my God, what do we do till the next episode? I have no idea what to do with myself. Like, that's how I feel now between Star Wars movies. And it's a year and a half. It's half the time it used to be. And I'm still like, this is way too long. I need it now.
I agree. That's, you know, maybe we should leave, have people feel that way about the Nerf Herder Council. And maybe we should close up shop on that note here.
All right. Yeah, let's do that.
We could do that. So
it'll give Steve time to get back from vacation and back to what he should be doing, which is being on the damn show.
He's got to save up for his next Disney vacation, which is, I think, November 16th, I think he said. So
that's right. Buy a lot of T-shirts, guys. He needs the money.
Yes, exactly. So thanks for tuning in to another episode of the Nerf Herder Council, everybody. Again, we are brought to you by Audible. Go to audibletrial.com/NHC for your 30-day trial and a free audiobook download. You can get our custom T-shirts on any color you want. There are 3 different logo designs that you can choose from, and any color T-shirt or promotional item you would like to print the logo on, you can do it there. It is teepublic.com/user/NHC podcast. So go there. Thanks to Galactic Empire. We appreciate them letting us use their music. It is awesome. Check out their 2 albums on Rise Records. You can find us at all of those fine podcast places that we usually tell you about. Google Podcasts, Apple Podcasts, all that stuff. Don't forget to leave us a 5-star review. We do have our Facebook page you can find us at. The website is nerfherdercouncil.com. You can interact with us directly by sending us an email, feedback@nerfherdercouncil.com. And we do have the show Twitter page that we are quite active on. It is @NHC Podcast. So until next time, I am your host, JT. He's AJ.
@DrakeAdams579. Where can they find you, JT?
What do you mean?
On Twitter?
Oh, I didn't say it, did I? I was.
Damn, dude! 3 years in, there was this one time you don't have your notes with you. And you're
I know.
Lost.
I always have it written down in front of me, and I don't. So, like, I am your host, JT at Dogbound Jedi. He's AJ
at Drake Adams 579.
He's not Steve this time, and
at Vacationing in Disney.
Yeah, at Vacationing in Disney. So check out my new Browns podcast, Dog Pound podcast. If you are a fan of the Cleveland Browns.
And, oh, hey, we've got one more anecdote.
Oh, we.
You teased it earlier
in the
show.
Oh, that's right.
We're not done yet, folks. Bonus material. Go for it, JT. What were you doing this week?
I won another Star Wars trivia contest.
Did you now?
I helped somebody win.
Ah, you're a free agent.
I was a free agent. There was a contest right up the street, and I wasn't going to go do it because you really weren't available, and I wasn't sure I was going to be able to get there on time. And at the last minute, we decided, let's just go up and watch. You know, it started at 6. We got there about 20 after. I was like, I'll just watch. And so we rolled in, and the guy was like, you here for Star Wars trivia? I'm like, yeah, we're here to watch. He goes, well, you don't want to join?
Smug look on your face, you said.
I said, no, I'm just here to watch. And he's like, you don't want to join? And I was like, nah. I was like, it's, you know, probably already started. He goes, no, we're still taking teams. You know, it's just about to start, but...
Were you really being cordial?
I was. I definitely was. I wasn't going to join.
Or like in the back of your head, are you like, I could crush all of you right now?
Well, no, I'll get there. But so we sat down next to this table with another couple.
It's like Luke walking into a Womp Rat targeting practice.
It kind of was. And this guy, you know, they were like, you know, you could join. And the guy's like, oh, this guy's got Star Wars on his arms. I was like, yeah, you know. And... there was a guy on the Facebook invite that had been talking trash with me. He started by saying, you know, they might as well just engrave my name on the trophy right now. And I said, you've never run into the juggernaut that is the Aluminum Falcons, have you? He says, I don't need to. I've got the power of the Millennium Falcon. And it was a picture of the Millennium Falcon where Will Smith's face was on Han Solo and Jada Pinkett Smith was on Leia's. And I'm like, you don't get to invoke the Millennium Falcon with me, you bastard. And I turned around and I saw him. And turned to the couple next to me and they said, are you playing Trivial Pursuit or Star Wars Trivial Pursuit here or whatever it is? And I was like, you know what? You want to just join up? He's like, yeah. I was like, he said, do you know Star Wars? And I said, I know a little bit. So I joined on his team. It was Let the Wookiees Win.
Nice.
Yes. And so I did not use the Falcon's name because you were not there. But... It was basically about a third of the way through the contest when I told him exactly what my sterling resume actually was. So I did let him answer. So anytime he knew an answer, I would just be like, you know, if you don't know, let me know. If you need the spelling, let me know. So, and it was kind of funny because one of the questions he said at the beginning, he goes, you know what? I hope they don't ask us how the hell to spell Kashyyyk. Cause there's no way I can spell that. I was like, well, I know what it is. So don't of you course. Know one of the questions was, what's Chewbacca's home planet? And bonus point, if you spell it right. And he looked over at me. I was like, three Y's, pal.
I got you.
And before we get to the victory, it's a very short story. I busted a team cheating. There was a table next to us that was neck and neck with us.
What?
Yes, I did. They basically what they did is the guy would ask the question. You had a dry erase board and you had to write it down. Turn it face down, and he's like, okay, everybody stop writing. All right, hold it up. So you hold it up and see if you got the right answer. So this team next to us, Steph caught him lip reading on me. So I was like, oh, okay. So a question comes up.
I'm just thinking about the bad lip reading Star Wars stuff on YouTube now.
Hit me in coconut. But, no, so...
Seagulls. Mm. Stop it now.
That's what I want to stop it now. So good. That should be the music for this episode.
Yeah, you're kind of pitchy.
I love that one.
Don't fall asleep.
But so the question was, how do sand people travel? And so I'm thinking, okay, this can be one of either two answers. It's either by bantha or single file. So I figured the questions have been really easy. So I'm figuring, okay, it's bantha. So I wrote down bantha, and then I purposely went, I looked at the guy next to me because I mean, I had to turn and face the other team, and I was like, yeah, I think it's single file. So don't you know this other team over there had been, Steph's like, I hear my ear, my wife says.
That's not really a wrong answer, though.
Yeah, but I knew it wasn't the right, I was pretty sure it wasn't the right answer for this. So they wrote down single file. So we proved that those assholes were cheating.
Nice.
And
nice.
So they lost a point because I purposely suckered them in. So there you go.
Was that the difference in the game?
No, because what happened was at the end in the final round, it was like Final Jeopardy. So how they counted up how many points you had, and then you had to bet a certain amount of points to make it into the finals, which was the top three teams.
Mm-hmm.
And so we had a lead of, I think, 2 points. So we bet one less than what we had, so that if we got it right, you know, we'd be in the finals no matter what. And if everybody else bet everything and we got it wrong, we'd still be in the finals. So it was kind of like a strategic thing. So we got in because these dummies that were lip reading said, you know, they didn't know Pit of Carcoon.
Everybody knows Pit of Carcoon.
No.
Even Steve knows Pit of Carcoon.
They said, where was the location of the beast that was supposed to eat Chewbacca, Han Solo, and Luke Skywalker? And it was Pit of Carcoon, and they didn't know it. They wrote down Sarlacc. They said, no, where the beast is located. So we made the finals, and basically five questions. We got all five. One team got four. Other team got three. So we won.
So it's you and Tom Brady competing for a number of rings now, right?
Yeah. So, you know, the Aluminum Falcons, whether helping other teams or doing it ourselves, remain undefeated.
Excellent, sir. Good on you, sir. Fist bump.
Fist bump.
Boom.
And all since right. We already did the outro, that was bonus material. We'll catch you next time.
This bucket of bolts is never going to get us past that blockade.
This bucket's got a few surprises left in her. Plus, me and Chewie are on it. Ain't that right, Chewie?
Hell yeah, you my Nerf herder.
You mad Nerf herder.